There's never been a costume that's been to do with Lord of the Rings that hasn't been challenging. Each costume that you're making requires so much love to get it to the point where you are willing to put it in front of a camera. For example, when we developed the Smeagol outfit, both Andy and I kept working on ideas, which was fabulous because you actually get to understand who he is, and it gave Andy the chance to think it through.
Given that his family were a fishing culture, we worked out that he'd have little bits of shells and fish hooks and things that meant something to him, and bits of things he'd found and dug up. But again, trying to retain the status of the character, I was trying to find ways of making him slightly more wealthy looking.
There is something about him that is slightly vain, that little neckerchief that he wears.
It was kind of slightly spotted and it slightly dandified him in some way.
So again, it comes back to starting to let the audience know beforehand that there is something about Smeagol that isn't as endearing as a hobbit.
We've had the same costume now for, you know, 4 years or whatever, and luckily Tolkien wrote that Pippin becomes a knight of Gondor, which means I get a right nice costume.
And Merry becomes a captain of Rohan. Both of these costumes are very intricate. In Pippin's case, beautiful black velvet with the embroidered tree of Gondor and silver on it, and the same with Merry's costume. It's very, very intricately embroidered with the double horse heads of Rohan. Sam and Frodo were given elven robes. Then we actually put a lot of effort into those. You know, once again, sort of trying out new techniques of acid etching into over-dyed velvets.
So we're looking smart. I think I've got the coolest one.
Action!
What are you two? Go back to the shithole!
This is Gandalf the White, of course. This was a tough one because how do you follow on from Gandalf the Grey and how do you create this version of Gandalf? Well, what we wanted was a much more virile Gandalf. And it was certainly how Ian McKellen viewed the character in this guise. I mean, he wanted to be able to fight. He wanted to be able to move. What we didn't want was the volume in the costume that we had had in Gandalf the Grey. The other thing that I wanted to do was to impart a little more elven quality, so that we had a sense of him being part one foot in another world. We used some very beautiful fabrics in this. Again, they're quite subtle, and the immediate version to the eye of this is just a cream costume, but it has a lot more happening than that. These designs here on the sleeve, elven designs, which is repeated through Elrond and other characters, so it's just been reworked into this costume. And then the undergarment is very much an elven fabric, which tied him into the elven world.
This immaculately embroidered gown can never be seen. There's no point in doing it, other than making me believe as I put them on that they're real clothes, which I do.
We started with a t-shirt. Then we had a shirt, then we got a robe, which is three layers.
But they never came up with any decent underwear for Gandalf. They did try.
We had this palette for Gondor, the sort of silvers and the blacks. Well, I stepped away from that with Faramir because I didn't want to relate too closely to Boromir. I wanted to keep him the younger brother.
Nyla had an idea that in terms of what Faramir did, the fact that he was a ranger in, through the forest of Ithilien or whatever, she had an idea that the costume should nearly be sort of similar in a way to Aragorn.
The ranger costumes were designed for the idea that they were very practical, that they were frequently on foot, and that they needed to be slightly camouflaged. So we definitely worked with a brown-green palette for these costumes. We used quite a lot of leather and oilskin, the idea being that both were warm and waterproof. We created this front piece, and we did this by creating a large die to actually stencil it in so that it had a relief quality to it to make it a little bit more interesting. Everything about Faramir is so much more genuine, but this sort of this terrible desire to please this hideous father. I came up with the look for Denethor in exactly the same way that I came up with everyone else. I just started drawing a portrait of him. How do you make this man menacing? How do you make him this man who is, you know, heading to the edge of sanity? We wanted to make him vain and expensive, to make him look like he is wearing the most luscious of fur pelts and velvets and embroidery, and just making it as grandiose as I possibly could without resorting to colour. And then, of course, adding in the chainmail.
That's the largest suit of chain that an actor would be able to wear for, say, 10 hours at a time.
Putting it on was a weight. But after a while, you'd forget about it. But then when I took it off in the evening, it would be floating. That was how heavy it was.
The vanity of the man that he imagined himself as a soldier of any kind, that was what fascinated me the most about that character. There needed to be sort of quite a clear idea that the Rohan people were a lesser civilization, I suppose, compared to Gondor. Eowyn is the niece of a king, so we wanted to make her clothes reflect that she's royalty, but also have a simplicity to them at the same time. This is the costume that you first meet Eowyn in. The garment itself is this green velvet, and then the underskirt is this leaf pattern, which has got quite a lot of metal thread in it. So it just gives a little bit of a kick in the light. And we took that piece of fabric as part of the underskirt and quilted it into this neck piece. These are Indian fabrics, and they've been put through quite heavy dye processes, which change the quality of the metal and make them look very antiqued.
It's such a beautiful colour, that green, and it's such heavy, heavy velvet. And when you moved, it just kind of swayed from side to side. It just had such great weight about it. She's, you know, the White Lady of Rohan, so the white dress was very important. It had to symbolise so many things, you know. It had to have that sort of medieval Lady of Rohan look, or princess look, if you like. But it also had to have a strength to it.
It's very simple, but has this elaborate gold and silver detail around the neck and really sort of beautiful interior sleeve linings and actually laces around the arms, exactly like this, but ultimately it crosses over in a very Saxon style when it's on her. And she looked fabulous in this dress.
Nyla sort of be whipping things up in about 3 days, and they actually turn into gorgeous frocks. I don't know how she does it.
We had already filmed a scene of Eowyn in the eggshell blue coat with the big fur collar, and then Peter wanted to shoot a scene earlier, so we needed to show the dress that was underneath this cloak.
She's ended up designing something that sort of sits over that, so it suddenly becomes this beautiful, regal banquet dress.
It was a chance to try a very different medieval design style that has a sort of separate embroidered front piece. And that turned out to be a really beautiful and very delicate dress. And I remember the premiere, and I remember thinking as that scene came up, oh my God, this is classic Peter, it's just a headshot. No point in having any ego when it comes to these things.
I wish there'd been more girls for her in it, because I think she liked having a chance to dress the girls, you know?
Yes, it was very much the relief for the wardrobe department to make some very beautiful dresses. This is what was known in the wardrobe as Arwen's dying frock. The first time Liv put this dress on, it was a magic moment and has continued to be so. The costume really began with these two colours, and once again, constantly over-dyeing these to get this aged red colour. And then we worked in this brocade. The girls in the wardrobe department have actually hand-stitched all of this embroidery. Hours, hours and hours of work. And these huge sleeves, they just drop right back, and so her arm will suddenly appear quite naked on screen, and it's incredibly sensual. Well, That's what the costume designer thinks. I had done this portrait of Liv wearing the coronation crown, which was based on the idea of a butterfly, and it had to have the hanging jewels. And my reason for that was that I wanted to frame her ears. So it was all about highlighting those fabulous little elfin ears.
In this film, I have this like incredible, almost like lime green dress.
Fran said that her and Peter would really like Arwen to be in green at the coronation. And so the mission of my dye house was to keep dyeing me up pieces of fabric in every possible shade of green until I fell in love with one of them. And finally, we found that green. It did all the things it needed to. It had enough blue in it to bring out the blue in Liv's eyes. It had enough yellow in it to ensure that it was still going to be green. It was soft enough to allow me to believe in it as a coronation gown.
Of course, it was more beautiful than I ever dreamed it could be.
Even on the set of Lord of the Rings in New Zealand, we can be stylish.
There's an enormous passion here, and it drives everything. The amount of people that have worked on every dress, from cutter to dyer to embroiderers to, you know, nights at 4 o'clock in the morning when there would be five people stitching each corner of a dress in order to get it finished in time.
Well, it works.
I mean, I just can't imagine just how much everyone has given to it. And if you didn't buy into that, then good and bad, then go and do something that's much better for your blood pressure.